The presentation that I will be doing today is based on a paper done by myself and Dr. Paqueo. This is written in response to the request of Secretary NEDA Secretary Chua on a sectoral analysis for education. It's primarily based on studies done at PIDS. The paper is being finalized to incorporate the comments from we sent the paper for comments for DepEd and TESDA and CHED. It will come out in the next few days, few weeks. Next slide, please. The outline of the presentation is structured in such a way that I'll answer three questions. So where are we now? Why are we here? And the way forward. And I'll start with basic education, higher education, the next higher education, the technical and vocational education. Next slide, please. I summarize the state of the basic education in these four statements. One is that the Philippines are at par with countries in terms of school attendance. We are way below our learning potential, and education continues to be a good investment. And finally, that responses to the pandemic reveal the challenges of remote learning. I will briefly substantiate these statements in the next slides. Next slide, please. This slide tells you, this graph is shows the World Bank data on expected years of schooling on the vertical axis and per capita income on the horizontal axis. It shows that the country compares well with its neighbors and aspirational peers in terms of school attendance. The graph shows that in terms of expected years of schooling, we are better than Malaysia, Thailand, and Indonesia and Vietnam. However, next slide, please. If we now turn to correct that with learning, we see that we are very much below our potential, and the rate estimates that's done by the World Bank is that our learning gap is 5 years. That means the 45 degree line is the that's supposed to show you where your learning is to your number of years of schooling. If you are below that, then that means that you have a learning gap. And most countries have learning gap, but ours is a very big one. So what if you want to translate that, 5.5 years of learning gap means that if you are a senior high school graduate with 12 years of schooling, you have only equivalent of 6.5 years of learning or first year in junior high school. So that's what it translates to. Next slide, please. Substantiating this is these three graphs from PISA, which tells you that this provides the relationship between per capita income and scores. And we are on the left, we already know that we are did not perform well in that. And I'd like to note the two things here is that we are below the solid line, the solid line, which means that we are again below the performance in terms of our income. The other thing that I'd like us to notice is that the graph, this is quite small, but it shows that the public is even lower than the private schools. Sometimes even the private school is above the expected performance. So, this data tells, this is from PISA. So this is the PISA tests 15-year-old students. That's why I'm saying that we are in a crisis, a learning crisis, and we are in a crisis for a while now. Because if you translate this, this is 15-year-old, that means that they are in school for 8 to 9 years already. And that's the performance that are compared to other countries. Next slide, please. This is the TIMSS results, which tests grade 4 students, and similar results if you have we are even further below given our income, and private school is still performing better than the public. Next slide, please. A good thing is that when you measure returns to education, it's still a good investment. It hurdles the basic cutoff of people use usually 10%. So it's still a good investment despite this problem. So that's one redeeming thing that we have. So that's why it's still good to send your children to school and returns. You still get the returns than most investments. The last slide that I'd like to show is really an important slide, because it's next slide, please. And because it shows the the response during the pandemic. This is a graph that tells you the distribution of students by mode of learning, and it's divided into elementary in the left, middle, and junior high school and senior high schools. The blue bars actually tells you the proportion of students who are on paper modules, meaning they receive paper rather than online. The green one tells you the online. So one of the things that you can observe right away that in public schools, almost 90% are in paper. They are not doing it online. And this is the result of the combination between schools, ability, schools and the households. And in the green one, they only see a little bit of a higher proportion of students in online modes in private schools. You don't see that in public schools. So that's one important lesson that we are saying, that this pattern in elementary and high school and junior high school and senior high schools is repeated. So most of our public schools are in public. So if this reveals a lot about the problems with remote learning that happened. And this is data in this school year 2020-2021. And that should tell us a lot of things. And I'll try to see the implications of that in the next few slides. Next slide, please. Okay, so why are we here? Basically, because we focus on access to the neglect with quality. For years, the issue we were solving was access, and inadvertently, we perhaps neglected quality. We only were awakened to this in recent years, essentially. So, the other thing that I'd like to, because we our analysis that we failed to build the culture of understanding learning and informing the public about the results of the national achievement set. Perhaps because of our forces in access, we did not put so much attention. We were not conscientious in understanding and learning the poor test performance of our students. Until the PISA and the TIMSS results showed us the magnitude, we failed to appreciate that a vast proportion of our students are below the minimum proficiency. Actually, the estimate is 80% of our students are in the PISA are below minimum proficiency. Finally, we failed to inform the public about the conditions of our schools and results of the national achievement tests. The literature is very clear that the public is a key partner because of the results of it, of tests are not just because of the schools. A large proportion of the educational outcomes because of household and community factors. So that's one thing that we should that perhaps we should be learning from, that we engage our stakeholders in the problems of our schools. Next slide, please. Of course, one of the things that we would like to highlight is we have underinvested in education. One of the things that you can is the proportion of our expenditures to GDP, and we are at 2.8 in 2019, compared to our neighbors Malaysia, which spends 4.2%, and Malaysia and Vietnam, and also Indonesia is even 3.6%. So we're not spend as our neighbors has been spending. And our education policies have undermined better performing private schools, perhaps unintentionally, but that's what the data is showing, that our policies are unintentionally perhaps undermining us, as I will explain a little bit in the next few slides. We failed to conscientiously check on the fidelity of the implementation of our major programs. For instance, in the case of the two programs that the Institute have reviewed, there were problems in implementation designs. For instance, the MTBLE, we find a confusion on what is it all about and what's the purpose of the program. And the senior high school, and we find out that even if we are encouraging students to go to employment after a senior high school, we see that most of them also go to college. So these realities have to be factored in the understanding of the performance of the program, so that we can be that the program will really achieve the stated objective. So and we know that there are guidelines that have been issued, we think that perhaps we fail to check on whether the guidelines are really implemented and failed. We just assume perhaps that because we issued the guidelines, we thought that those were followed closely. But as I've said, in the two cases that we look at, they were not followed as designed. Okay, next slide, please. So what's our way forward? Of course, the improving quality is key. Now, everybody appreciates this by now. The question is, how do we do it? Essentially, that's basically the and these are we need rigorous validation of the classroom experience. For we appreciate that the PED, for instance, has pushed schooling education with us four pillars. But let me just try to describe to discuss what we should be doing in that. So the first one is the first curriculum review and update, and that's being done and actually being released. And we should be looking at how this has improved, whether this changes in curriculum has achieved our objectives. And that's one. We actually reduced our learning competencies during the pandemic from 14,000 to 5,000, and call it the most essential learning competencies. And we should know what happened with that with the reduction. Third one, the second pillar of the student calendar is learning, improving the learning environment. So we should know which dimension. The PISA test tells us the high prevalence of bullying. And that school discipline is a very big factor in terms of test scores. And we find out an odd thing that our learning time is not related to the test scores. So that's, we should look at what's happening during just learning times where expecting it to be positive on the scores, but it's not affecting test scores. And the other thing that is teachers are feeling and strain. Again, we ask them which dimension and how. The PISA results is showing that there's no correlation between teacher qualification and test scores. So that's the thing that we should be thinking about. And finally, engagement of stakeholders and what. And the establishment of the education forum is laudable because that's a forum where we continue to engage and inform stakeholders on what's happening in our schools. And we know already, as I mentioned earlier, that the public is a very big factor in terms of improving or understanding the problems about school. So we need, it boils down to the need to organize, to promote a virtuous, what I call virtuous cycle of teaching and learning. Teachers should not just be taught about how to impart knowledge, but actually they should be taught as well how to learn from classroom experience so that they can improve the learning friction in subsequent meetings. Thus, the DepEd should transform itself not just a teaching institution, but a learning institution as well for teachers and administrators. We should agree on the clear indicators of quality. For instance, a good one is would be a proportion of enrolled students who are satisfying the minimum proficiency grade, and consistently measure that on how our programs have improved that indicator. Organize continuously and assess the learning and learn from education. We should be learning from our programs, as I've said, and look at that and how it's implemented and what are the issues and whether it's achieving its programs. It should be part of our cultures, and we should build that culture of trying to assess what is happening and learning from those things. Next slide, please. And the systematically develop a remedial program. This is because of what the PISA is telling us, that we should be very clear that we need a remedial program, and it should for many students, at least 80% of our students, and we should target those from the poorer students, because those are the ones that are likely to have very large lags in terms of learning. And we should, rather than undermining the private sector, we should expand utilization of the better performing private schools by using vouchers. And finally, I would like to, the implications that I'd like to address that they should harness technology for more learner-centered education. I think the enrollment by modality is telling us that online will not work for our public schools, because most of our students are in paper, not on. Or not. If you just provide online the schools, the students will not be able to access it. I think what's needed is much more lower level technology, like for example using cell phones to interact between to increase the interaction between between teachers and students, and that to complement the paper modules that they are actually using. They can't access online. Only the private schools have a semblance of online learning. Okay, next slide. So going now to higher education. Next slide, please. Okay. So five statements. Attendance is high again in for our income levels, qualities, and even and low in quality. Sorry, I have to go past because I'm running out of time. And qualities and even and low quality equity access remains elusive, and there's an underdeveloped research and innovation system, and the private sector is still being marginalized. Okay, well, that's the five main. Next slide, please. So the next slide will tell you, I'll go ahead of the slides, that tells you that our enrollment rate has been at par with our the same thing as with our basic education. We are at par with our neighbors in terms of enrollment. Next slide, please. But if you look at the quality of our very few universities is actually part of the top 1,000 universities. Next slide, please. And this table tells you the quality indicators that are like less than 40% of our graduates pass the board exams, and only 20% of before that. That's fine. This tells you about the equity that only 17% of our poorest actually go to attend higher education, and like 49% it's for the richest. And the next slide tells you that next slide please, tells you that the distribution even in public schools is not true that the students in public schools are poor. It's just evenly distributed. They are actually underrepresented, the poor underrepresented even in public schools. So that's a thing that much more of course for the private school. Next slide please. And the other thing that I'd like to highlight is a recent result by Professor Dawai of the School of Economics, which tells you that entrance in UP is very much determined by income, and even in the competition for limited slots in higher education, the poor could be competed out. So this slide tells you about the other issues in the STEMs graduates, the underdeveloped research in research and innovation has three components that STEM graduates lack exposure for research. This is a result of the USAID STRIDE research, the earlier study by Dr. Vea on academia industry. Collaboration is still in infant emergent stages, that's what the term is used. And the recent results by Dr. Albert said that they have a limited ECNT manpower in the Philippines. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is the tells you the private sector is being the share, the enrollment has declined by 0.8% annually since 2009. So that's what I'm telling, by design or not, it's what's happening. And actually, the free tuition law exacerbates this, as this, the next slide will tell you that. We'll tell you the first. This next slide tells you that the first year enrollment. This is the first year enrollment. Prior to the introduction of the senior high school, of course, it dipped in senior high school where 2 years we didn't have enrollment. But when it came back, when enrollment came back in 2019, we find out the public schools have more than recoup the enrollment that they have 112%, like 800,000 against 715,000. But in private school only, they were only able to recoup 69% of their pre senior high school enrollment. So that's what this thing tells you. And that's not shown in the slide is the telltale sign of our of job education mismatch done by our tracer studies. Okay, so why are we here? Essentially, the low quality starts with in basic education. So what higher education is doing is actually mostly remedial of what's lost in basic education. And recent changes in public finance, we don't believe that it will solve the equity issue. We are and the education policy is marginalizing the public, the private sector, and the lack of exposure of the culture and academic industry is still preventing for to have vibrant R&D in universities. Next slide, please. So the higher we should find better financing to include to improve the access issue. And I said that the more targeted one is a better method rather than block grants to public universities, and address the uneven quality by enforcing rules on closure and closing programs hire encouraging people student universities to have centers of excellence and development and promote accreditation. And next slide please. Again, we should be promoting we should be harnessing the private sectors and their capacities rather than undermining them, and of course develop our R&D culture. Let me try to a few slides for Tibet. Next slide, please. So for our Tibet, I think the ones that we're seeing high enrollments in Tibet and actually certification as well. There is an increasing proportion of portion of graduates coming from community-based mode of learning, and the sectoral distribution of graduates appears to correspond to the fast-growing sectors of the economy, and there's a shifting composition and reasons for having Tibet, and that's let me try to go fast on that, and I think go fast on the I ran out of time already. Okay, sige. Okay, thanks, Sheila. I can take time. So basically, this is the previous slide. This tells you that the enrollment in Tibet is actually rising, and certification is rising as well. And this table is telling you that there is the increasing. Next slide is the increasing proportion is now on community-based community-based training rather than on TVI-based or industry-based training. Okay, next slide, please. So this graph tells you that the fastest growing or the more enrollments is going to our fast growing sectors, like for example tourism and social and community development and information and technology, which used to be top sector in terms of enrollment for Tibet has gone down already in the middle, and so I think our reading is that so the training has responded to the changes in the growth of the sectors. Next slide, please. So this is this graph is very interesting. It says that actually what the composition of trainees now is very much more like the brown one is actually on the left hand side is the level of educational attainment. So you have, it used to be that Tibet is supposed to be for high school graduates, but what's coming out in recent data is that more college graduates, the brown one and beyond, are in Tibet as well as college undergraduates. And the right graph is telling you the reason. It used to be that reason is for the top reason is for employment, but now it's upgrading for skills. So it tells you that it reveals what people going into Tibet are actually trying to do with their technical education. Okay, so I'll the implications of that I'll show in the next four slides. Next slide, please. So why are we here? I think we have not promoted enterprise-based training well. I think TESDA has pointed out that they have actually have TESDA circulars promoting that, but somehow that's what I'm saying, that perhaps when we issue memorandums, you should check whether it has an effect or not. But from the data that I'm showing you, the enterprise-based training, which is supposed to be the best training because it is based on in industry, is the lowest proportion of output. The highest proportion, as I've said, is community development. So it's not, we should look at that, and the emphasis on equity perhaps is the one that triggers the large proportions of community-based training, and we should be, because that has certain features that we should be watchful about, and so we should look at that as well. And I think what our graduates are saying, what our trainees are seeking, are employable skills. So now college graduates who are going into TVET after graduation, or even college students or graduations, are actually seeking employable skills. So perhaps it tells us that perhaps our tertiary education is not preparing them enough to the changes in the labor market. So that's why they're packing up employable skills by going into TVET. Next slide, please. Last few slides. So the way forward, so we have to promote the responsibility to the Tibetan industry, and we have been at this for a while now, but data seems not to be moving. So what this is telling us is that test the issuance is not sufficient. We have to do something to promote the strong linkage between the industry and training. There's also the need for incorporating the Tibet as 21st century skills, and TESDA has been saying that they have issued circular on this as well. So we should be checking whether the TESDA's training really included this, because that the industry is saying that what are needed is not just pure technical skill, but 21st century is like relating, communicating what you need, and relating with your co-workers, and even so that's the thing that should be included in TVET as well. They're not just hired for the skills, but for other things beyond the skills. So develop, perhaps because of this, we should develop the capacity of tests that will be testing on modalities on how to conduct training, such that it would respond to the needs of the industry, and improve the outcomes of the matching between training and industry needs. And we should not forget that training is not just for equity purposes, meaning that basic training is needed for some people, but we have, because of changes in technology, we should prepare ourselves for high technology, high precision equipment require high technology training. So that we should not be forgetting as well. Even as we address the equity requirements, we should be looking at the high, because that's where technology is moving, and preparing our workers for that kind of training. And the last one I think I should mention is that the pandemic has told us that we should develop our flexible learning delivery capacity. And I think the TESDA online program is a trailblazer in this space. We should strengthen that program. But as we pointed out in one of our papers, that we should always remember that the types of the clients that we have. It's not only in basic education, but we find also we don't have data for higher education, but we find also from the little survey that we did for trainees, that one program, for instance, had to lend them tablets in order to be able to access the online part of the training. And of course, there's still the problem of the hands-on part, because even if it can be done by simulations, our training institutes don't have equipments for simulations. And so we should be developing capacity for flexible training delivery as well, and that requires investments. I think this is my last slide. The last slide is the so let me summarize the recommendations. One is focusing on quality. That should be what should be our focus now. It's not no longer we are no longer problems with access. That's post-box and how to improve quality. I think the next one is the one that will help us. We should build the culture. We should not be defensive too much. We should build a culture of generating and reporting and discussing and learning from data on quality and performance. We should, like for example, if we have a test, how do we improve our performance in classes? We have our exam scores, right? Are we afraid that looking at our exam scores? We should not be, because that tells us how much we have learned. So we should build that culture of facing our issues squarely and ask the help of everyone, because as I've said, test scores is not a problem of schools. Problem of the households as well, and we should be in helping each other to do. And I address quality equity issues better. As I've said, the putting money on public schools will not solve the problem, because as I've shown you, the enrollment in public school is not poor. It's just evenly distributed. So if you provide a free education in public schools, you'll finance the rich as well. You could have targeted it to the poor if you want to really increase the number of the poor in our higher education system, and develop a culture of R&D. This is one of the things that's quite a difficult, complex thing to do, but we should build the systems for that. And we should optimize the contribution. The private sector is there for and performing well. We should be using them, not undermining them. In terms of, we should make them contribute what they are good for, and using them in any way. And of course, as the pandemic has showed that, we should be flexible we should adapt flexible learning, but I'm saying that in public, in basic education, or maybe in private, in Tibet as well, we are shown that doing online will not work, because most of our students are on paper. What will perhaps work is that providing teachers with cell phone load so that they can talk to the students and do interaction as they read the paper module. Online will only serve the richer ones who have access at home, but not but most of our public schools are, as I've said, 90% of our students are on paper. I think that's the last one that we should be strategic in terms of using technology. Thank you very much. I think that's my last one.